Hello everyone! We noticed that a large number of you guys watch our videos without subscribing, so what's stopping you? Click here to stay updated with our latest nerdy content. And back to the video.
Assalamu alaikum everyone, welcome back to another ATP video. Today, we'll be talking about Clostridia family. It'll be a short and concise video, and we hope you find it beneficial. Clostridia is a group of bacteria, all of whom have three things in common. They all form spores, they all are obligate anaerobes, and they all form toxins. There are four clinical important species: Clostridium tetani, Clostridium botulinum, Clostridium perfringens, and Clostridium difficile. Now let us dig a little bit deeper and talk about their important features. We'll talk about each one separately, starting with Clostridium tetani. Clostridium tetani is usually found as spores in soil, and they enter the body via penetrating injury. A classic scenario would be stepping barefoot on a rusty nail or splinter. Once the spores get into the body, they germinate into bacteria, and a tetanus toxin called tetanospasmin is produced. The toxin travels via the bloodstream and lymphatics to the peripheral nerve terminals and then to the CNS. It's important to know that tetanus toxin travels retrograde through motor neurons to the spinal cord. Retro means backwards. Once it reaches the spinal cord, it blocks glycine and GABA release from Renshaw cells, which are inhibitory interneurons that regulate the motor neurons' activity. The inhibition of those inhibitory cells leads to unopposed overactivation of the motor neurons, causing spastic paralysis. From the pathogenesis that we've just explained, we can expect that patients who become infected with Clostridium tetani to develop symptoms like spasms, muscle contractions, and rigidity. One of the classic symptoms is lockjaw or trismus, which is inability to open the jaw. The other classic symptom is risus sardonicus, which is the sustained spasm of the facial muscles that appears to produce grinning. Treatment of Clostridium tetani includes the debridement if any wounds present. The antibiotic that is usually given is metronidazole. Tetanus immunoglobulin can also be given, which binds the circulating toxin, but not the one that has been already taken up by Renshaw cells. And that's the reason we give benzos, or neuromuscular blockers, until the toxin effect wears off. Nowadays, tetanus rarely happens due to the development of tetanus vaccine, which is a toxoid vaccine. Now let us move on to Clostridium botulinum. Clostridium botulinum can be found in many places like vegetables, fruits, seafood, soil, etc. It produces heat-resistant spores that can survive up to 100 Celsius. Botulinum toxin works at neuromuscular junctions to prevent acetylcholine release, resulting in floppy muscles, because acetylcholine is responsible for movement. And this type of paralysis is opposite to the spastic paralysis that occurs with Clostridium tetani. Remember, Clostridium botulinum works on the peripheral nervous system, not central nervous system like Clostridium tetani. There are three types of botulism: food, infant, and wound. The food type mainly affects adults, and it usually occurs due to the ingestion of toxins. A classic scenario would be a group of people who got infected due to consumption of canned or undercooked food. The infant type happens due to the ingestion of spores, which then germinate in the intestines. A classic scenario is an infant who has eaten honey contaminated with botulinum spores. Lastly, the wound type, which happens due to the growth of botulinum in a dirty wound. For the symptoms, it takes about 12 to 48 hours after ingestion of the toxins for the symptoms to appear. They can be summarized by the 6 Ds. Diplopia, which means double vision, dysphonia, which means abnormal voice, dysphagia, which means difficulty swallowing, dry mouth, mydriasis, which is pupil dilation, and lastly, dyspnea, which is difficulty breathing. So as you can see, it usually has a descending nature for the symptoms to appear. Diagnosis is often clinical, but sometimes spores and toxins can be detected in the stool. For the treatment, we give an antitoxin that blocks the circulating toxin, but not the one already in the nerves. And all we can do is provide supportive care until the toxin washes out. Interestingly, botulinum toxin is also used as treatment in many disorders. For example, botulinum toxin A, also known as Botox, is used to treat focal dystonia, muscle spasms, cosmetic reduction of facial wrinkles, cerebral palsy, achalasia, and vaginismus. Clostridium perfringens is also found widespread in nature, especially in soil. It's highly associated with military combat wounds and motorcycle accidents, and it can either infect dirty wounds or cause food poisoning. Clostridium perfringens can cause gas gangrene, also known as clostridial myonecrosis. This happens in traumatic wounds with vascular compromise because this creates a favorable environment for anaerobic growth. Clostridium perfringens produces alpha toxin, which destroys muscle tissue and causes gas gangrene, which is characterized by crepitus in soft tissue, and hemolysis. This is because the toxin is a phospholipase that acts on lecithin, which means it can degrade phospholipids in cell membranes, leading to hemolysis. Clostridium perfringens can cause food poisoning, especially after consumption of undercooked meat. Also, food that is left standing for too long allows spores to germinate. Ingestion of those spores will lead to toxin production inside the body. This will cause a late onset watery diarrhea that happens usually 8 to 22 hours after ingestion. Keep in mind that it's different from diarrhea caused by Staph aureus or Bacillus cereus, which is caused by perfringens toxins since they cause early onset diarrhea. For the treatment, penicillin and clindamycin can be used to treat Clostridium perfringens infection. Finally today, we have Clostridium difficile. Clostridium difficile, also known as C. diff, is the most common out of the whole family. Its spores are also found everywhere in nature, including soil. Ingestion of C. diff is not harmful with normal GI flora, as the colonic flora prevent overgrowth of C. diff. It is harmful in cases where the normal gut flora has been altered, such as in people taking antibiotics. It causes antibiotic-associated colitis in those people, because antibiotics alter normal gut flora, making it a favorable environment for C. diff growth. C. diff causes disease via production of toxins. Two of these toxins include toxin A, which is an enterotoxin, and it binds to brush border cells of the intestines and causes inflammation, cell death, and watery diarrhea. The second toxin is toxin B, also known as cytotoxin, which causes actin depolymerization, leading to disruption of cytoskeleton, causing cell necrosis. It's good to know that toxin B is much more potent than toxin A, which is why it's much more important. Both toxins bind to GI cells and are internalized. They cause destruction of the cytoskeleton of GI cells, leading to production of pseudomembrane in the colon, which is the formation of white-yellow plaques due to the mucosal ulcerations, fibrin deposition, and inflammatory cells. Infection with C. diff leads to massive watery diarrhea, and in severe cases, it can cause a leukomoid reaction or toxic megacolon. A patient with abdominal pain, distension, bloody diarrhea, fever, and shock in the setting of C. diff is most likely presenting with toxic megacolon. A classic case of C. diff colitis would be a patient who presents with abdominal pain, diarrhea, leukocytosis, and a recent antibiotic use. For the diagnosis, it can be done via nucleic acid amplification test, or PCR. Also, stool assay can be used to detect toxins of C. diff. Clostridium difficile colitis can be treated with oral vancomycin or metronidazole. Therapy for severe, recurrent disease is fidaxomicin, or surgery or stool transplant. Many antibiotics can lead to C. diff colitis, such as clindamycin or ampicillin. Proton pump inhibitors like omeprazole are also associated with it. One thing to keep in mind while treating a C. diff patient is the extra contact precautions that should be taken, and that includes washing hands with soap and water, changing gloves after contact with any secretions, and leaving the stethoscope and blood pressure cuff in the room as well. Keep in mind that alcohol-based hand sanitizer cannot kill spores, and that's why washing hands with soap and water is quite important. Alright, to sum up, today we have talked about Clostridia family. It's a very dense topic, and now we're going to summarize the most important points. Clostridium tetani and Clostridium botulinum both produce neurotoxins and both cause paralysis. Clostridium tetani causes tetanic paralysis or spastic paralysis, while Clostridium botulinum causes floppy paralysis. Clostridium perfringens causes gas gangrene. Both Clostridium perfringens and C. diff cause diarrhea. Clostridium perfringens causes late onset watery diarrhea, while C. diff cause severe watery diarrhea associated with antibiotic use. And that's it for Clostridium. We hope you find it beneficial. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to receive our latest videos. And as always, thanks for watching.